What is going on over there, Luna?
Nothing.
Are we having a fag?
Yes.
Are we? Okay, then.
Yes.
Let me join you, because I need one, too.
Okay.
Oh, so much better.
So refreshing.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to Talking with Demons. Good evening. Good Tuesday evening to everybody. How are you ladies doing tonight?
Practically perfect, as always.
Practically perfect.
Practically. This much from being perfect.
Just yes. This close from being perfect.
Just this close.
How are you, Ina?
I'm great. And today, since you didn't ask, but I'm going to tell you anyway, it's Book Lovers Day.
Ooh. It's Book Lovers Day.
Yep.
Well, I'm not celebrating this day then.
Me neither.
But come on.
I thought I should say it just in case. So you don't miss the fun fact of the day.
It doesn't work for me, does it? Anyway, hello, everybody. Welcome to the show. Jace, how are you doing, buddy? Mary Beth, good evening to you. Rex, hello. How is everybody doing? Everybody just, I can't keep up with everything. Hello, Ina. Mary Beth saying hello to you.
Oh.
Kristen, hello. Rex saying hello to everybody as well. Hello, Sid, Luna, and Mama Rex. Bear. Look, I'm excited about tonight.
Are you? Really?
Just a little bit. A bit nervous, a bit excited, a little bit of all kinds of things, I guess. But, yeah, I'm excited for tonight's show.
All excited.
How excited? Let's do it. You didn't ask how excited. I was about to tell you, too.
Let's pretend I asked, though.
I'm so excited that my that my nipples are hard.
Can we see?
It happens. That's
just
that's
back up a bit.
Let's see. Let's see your titties.
No, I'm not showing my titties.
Fine. You're not fun.
Not today. Maybe, you know what? This was the second show and I didn't put the butt on my forehead yet.
Oh.
I forgot.
You don't need
for
to do
shame.
That.
It's for okay. Shame.
Anyway, welcome to the show, everybody. Without further ado, I'm going to introduce to you guys an individual that I could say was his music's had a big part of my life. He's been around for 20 plus years, banging out some hits in the early days of Saliva. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the legend himself, Josey Scott, to the show. Welcome, buddy.
What's
welcome
up?
To the show, man.
What's up, Sid? How are you doing?
I'm okay. I'll survive. Hey.
Hello.
We're
ladies.
Here too.
Hello.
Finally. Hi.
Sorry.
Ladies first.
That's right.
Well, okay, let's make it right then, Josey. Let's do it right. Hello, Ina. Hello, Luna.
Hello, Ina.
Hello, Luna.
Welcome to the show, Josey. That's since you're last now.
Thank you for having me. I'm honored.
Thank you for taking the time out of your busy schedule here lately. Hanging out with us, man. I appreciate it.
My pleasure.
I know you got a lot of wheels are turning over there in your world, and it's cool that you're taking the time out this evening and hanging out with us.
Absolutely, man.
So how you been? First of all, how have you been?
I've been doing good, man. Just getting the final touches of my band together and We're all meeting up here in Tulsa, Oklahoma in a few days to do a couple of rehearsals, and then we're going to bang out a show here in Tulsa at my friend's. He's got this huge water park, and we're playing at, his name's Safari Joe. He has all these cool exotic animals, and he's got like lions and tigers and snakes.
Oh my.
This ain't a character off the Tiger King, is it?
No, I actually asked him one time if he was friends with that guy, and he said that he knew him from back in the 90s when he tried to buy some animals from him, but he said he didn't feel, he didn't feel like his animals would be cared for in the way that he cared for them, so he like refused to sell him a couple of tigers back in the day. And he's got beautiful tigers, like white tigers, tabbies, all kinds of different exotic animals. Next time we're gonna get
updated pictures of Josey taking selfies with tigers and shit.
Well, when I was down here, when me and my wife were dating in the early 2000s, I think it was like 2003, and I got to hold a 6 week old white tiger. I got to hold it in my arms, and he said, enjoy holding it and petting it. He said, because in six months, she'll be deadly. I was like, damn.
Impossible. My furry little baby.
She was so sweet though. It was just like holding a baby. I got to feed her and everything. But he has all kinds of beautiful exotic animals, and he has this beautiful water park with all kinds of fun stuff to do, and he has an adult night, or he's got a couple of bars there inside the water park, and all these people get together for like rock and roll night or whatever at his water park. So we're excited to play that show.
How long has it been since you've performed?
It's been, besides doing a couple of guest spots on stage with different buddies, being on stage and doing a complete set of my own, it's been 10 years.
When we say 10 years, literally, it has been a freaking decade since you've done anything. One of the hardest things that I tried to find was just music that you did outside once you left. Because I was searching, right, like, what was Josey doing outside once he left Saliva? And I pressed really hard to find anything. I mean, you literally stopped doing what you was doing. There he goes.
Yeah.
Disappeared like magic.
Yeah, I just got, I think as a musician, you start out with every good intention in the world. And we had never had a record deal and had, you know, we were just poor kids from Memphis, Tennessee, and I didn't even have a high school diploma. I had quit high school in the 11th grade, and you know, all of a sudden you just have $100,000 thrown in your pocket, and
I meant to ask you that. He was playing for a band called Blackbone at the time. Uh-huh. It was back in 95, if I'm not mistaken. Is that one, 95, 96, somewhere around there?
Yeah, I was in Blackbone in 95, and that kind of fell apart, and I went into a depression, and I was living with my mother at the time, and I went and just boarded myself up in my bedroom and wrote like 40 songs, and then once I was coming out of this black, dark depression I was in, then I hit the streets and started stealing. I had no conscience. Like, I went to all the best bands in Memphis and took this lead guitar player and that bass player and that drummer. And I was like, look, do you guys want to go dominate the entire earth, or do you want to be hometown heroes for the rest of your life? Either way, I'm about to do this. So you guys can.
Well, to be fair, back then, the music was in a strange space at that period of time. You know what I mean? In the 80s, yeah, you had the hair metal, and then, you know, that went away when the 90s came along. Then you had that short period of time where grunge was the scene. And then towards the latter part of the 90s, rock music was trying to find its footing again, I think. And then that's when the bands like Saliva, bands like Limp Bizkit, Stain, bands like that kind of changed the trajectory of music and created a whole new genre, to be fair.
I agree. I totally agree with that. It was like sort of a rock and roll no man's land there for a minute, and everybody was, you know, trying to figure out which way they wanted to go. And when the Blackbone thing was ending, I just thought to myself, like, I love Nirvana. I just thought the sun rise and set in Nirvana. So I was like, I'm going to come up with a cool band name like Nirvana. I got to come up with something that's already a household word. And I was like, Saliva. I was like, that's cool. I was like, you know, it's going to freak people out. It's going to gross people out. And then you can't have sex without it.
And, I mean, what a perfect way to launch like a major label album by naming the album every 6 seconds.
Yeah, well, the reason I did that is because men think about sex about every 6 seconds. So.
And you're going to need saliva for that.
Is that true?
Right.
Is that absolutely true?
Some sort of saliva.
Absolutely.
Every 6 seconds.
Yeah, something, you know, it could be the smallest little thing. You know, I could turn and see, you know, somebody coming out of a restaurant, or, you know.
Rock music at the time, just at that period of time, didn't have an identity at all. Right. And so when you was thinking of creating Saliva, and you had these like hip hop sort of influences melding in with the hard rock sound, mm-hmm. When you started putting that together for Saliva, like for every 6 seconds, you had to have known that this was going to propel the band and what you're doing in somewhere totally in a different place.
Absolutely. I told the guys when we first got together, I said, you know, my biggest influences were always like AC/DC and, you know, Kiss and Motley Crue and stuff like that. And then later on in life, my favorite influences were like the Beastie Boys and Run DMC and, bands like that. And I told the guys, I said, I want to be, and then Rage Against the Machine came out and just totally changed my life. Like, just, I didn't stop listening to Rage Against the Machine. I think I listened to them for the entire rest of the 90s. I don't think Rage Against the Machine
my cassette tape listening to Rage Against the Machine. That thing never left my cassette player in my truck.
Absolutely. And then I went and seen them live in St. Louis. I remember I went with this girl from Memphis, and we like traveled and slept outside for tickets, and then we went to the show and were just absolutely blown away by Rage Against the Machine. And I was like, that is what I want to do, and that's what I'm gonna do. And so I told the guys when I put Saliva together, I said this is real simple. I said, I don't want to get complicated. I said, I want hip-hop style choruses or hip-hop style verses, good heavy bouncy guitars with that Memphis bounce. You know, me and Chris Tibaldo, the lead guitar or the rhythm guitar player were all about that Memphis bounce, that 666 Mafia. Just we were all about that, and I said, we're gonna have rap verses, and we're gonna have big, humongous ass choruses that nobody can argue with. It's gonna be undeniable. Every song, not just the singles, not just the songs we put out, but every single song has to be undeniable.
He was creating something that was never been done outside of a few times with bands like Anthrax and Public Enemy, Aerosmith, Run DMC. It was only done a few times. No band that I can recall ever decided to take a shot at doing that meld together, where that you got that hip hop rhythm and rhymes with that metal in the background. And it just fucking, when I heard it, I was like, I'm not, and I stopped myself because I was into the 80s metal. I liked my grunge, but I wasn't sold on grunge. You know what I mean? I liked it, but I wasn't sold on it. And then when I heard Your Disease, I was like, what in the fuck is this? Yeah. This is genius.
Well, it's like when Aerosmith and Run DMC did that song together, it'd be like if a girl showed you part of her leg, you know what I mean? We just saw the little hem of the girl's dress. We just saw the girl's dress come up, and we saw a little bit of the leg and a little bit of the thigh. We wanted to tear the dress off. We wanted to see what the rest of it looked like.
I mean, that had to have been a bit exciting, but a bit nervous as well, to be fair. Because I listened to your self-titled album, I guess. Mm-hmm. It wasn't a major label release, I don't believe, right?
No. It was just that was just something we put together there in Memphis, because the fans in Memphis were just saying, please just give us anything. We'll just take any kind of CD you guys put together.
You evolved from that self-titled album to Every 6 Seconds was like almost totally two different bands. You got hints mm-hmm. of what Every 6 Seconds was going to sound like, but yet it was still, you know, far to the left in a way, in mm-hmm. a sense.
Well, and at the time we had Todd Poole was actually in the band, the original. He was actually the singer for an 80s metal band called Roxy Blue, and he decided to be the drummer in Saliva in the beginning. So we wrote that first record with Todd Poole, and then by the time Paul came along, we were writing songs like Dope Ride and Your Disease and Click Click Boom. And then we'd been turned down by every label. We had Nickelback's manager, Brian Coleman. He came and he said, look, I'll manage you guys on a handshake. He said, you don't have to sign any paperwork. No, nothing like that. He said, give me 6 months, and if I don't have you guys a deal, then you can let me go, you can pass on me. And so we did the handshake deal with Brian Coleman, and like I said, we got turned down by Capitol and RCA and every single label passed on us almost twice. Because we were just beating their door down.
Music, and they're going, what is this? They probably didn't even know how to take it.
Well, what they would do.
Right.
And what they would do back then is they would invite you out to their city to put you up in like one of those gigantic rehearsal studios. And then they would, you know, just stand there with their arms folded long enough to tell you that you weren't good enough. And when Island Def Jam came along, they said, who the hell is this Memphis band called Saliva that's selling 10 or 15,000 units all by themselves and selling out shows? And they got all this radio airplay because a radio station there in Memphis, 92 WMFS, I think it was just banging us out all the time. They were just playing our music back to back on the radio. So when Island Def Jam got a hold of us, they were like, who in the hell are these kids that are doing this by themselves? And when we got on the phone with them, it was right after, I believe, I think Atlantic Records had passed on the band, and my father had just died. So I was in, like, I was in this, my give a damn was busted. And so when Island Def Jam called and they said, look, we're going to bring you out to New York City. We're going to put you guys up in a nice hotel. We're going to take you out to dinner and then we'll bring you over to this rehearsal studio and we're going to have a showcase. And I was like, nope. I was like, nope, not happening. I said, listen, and I was on a 5-way phone call with Brian Coleman and the head of A&R at Island Def Jam. And then the guy that would be our future A&R guy, Rob Stevenson, and Lior Cohen, the CEO, one of the godfathers of hip hop, was on the phone. And I said, look, man, if you want to see us, you're going to have to come to Memphis. I said, and let me sell out the New Daisy Theater on Beale Street with 1,500 kids, and let me rock the fuck out of that party. And then you can tell me no. Then you can look me in my eye and tell me no, tell me I'm not good enough. Because if that ain't good enough, then I don't know what's good enough. So there was this long pause on the phone call, like 15, it felt like an eternity, man. It must have been about 15 seconds. And we were just all sitting there, and I heard Lior go, okay, we'll come to Memphis. And I was like, they came to Memphis, and the rest is history, man. We rocked the party just like I predicted. And the next thing you know, they sent over what's called a deal memo. And our lawyers and their lawyers went back and forth. And I was even scared about that. I was like, well, how does this work? I was like, you can't tell them no. And they're like, no, Josey, calm down. This is how it works. They send their first draft. We send our second draft. They send it. And they go back and forth. Well, they finally went back and forth, and they finally got the deal together. And then FedEx lost my deal in the mail. And I was freaking out, man. So
they're good at that.
a couple of days later, I finally got the deal at my mother's house on Green Dolphin Street, right there in Memphis, Tennessee. And this is right after my mother's friend had told me, you need to think about your future and you need to think about what you're going to do with your life. And maybe you should go back to school and all this stuff. So
it sounds like you've practiced with that voice. That's your motivator voice right there.
That is my motivator, Karen voice. Absolutely. So when the record deal finally got to my mom's house, I ripped it open, and I had this old Holy sweater from Gap that I used to wear back in the grunge days. And I literally took a steel staple gun and stapled it to my sweater and walked around with it on my sweater for like a week. My mom and her friends were sick of me. I was like, look at this. In your face, mother.
Is this the picture of success? Is this what you're talking about? Anything about my future?
Yeah.
As you got trickles of blood coming off your chest where you stapled the gun.
Does this look like a guy that needs to go back to school? I think not. But no, we were so excited and so thankful and so grateful. We literally went through hell. And anybody that says, you know, that we didn't pay our dues, that's, it's just not true. We played every small town and every bar and
man, it was harder back then. It's not like it is today. I mean, you can go on the internet and put your music out anytime, any place, anywhere you want to. Back then, it wasn't like that.
Yeah,
there was a lot of work that had to be done.
Absolutely, and we played for bar tabs and slept on pool tables, and I remember me and Cristobaldo digging quarters out of the carpet of our little Chevy van so we could get together enough quarters to go to 7-Eleven because they had like a 2 hot dog special, and we would split a hot dog together. We were literally starving artists. So anybody who thinks that we didn't pay our dues is just incorrect. We totally paid some hella dues. But back to what it was like to go from digging quarters out of the van carpet to having $100,000 thrown in your pocket. I was just footloose and fancy free, man. I was making it rain, dude. I went crazy, dog.
It didn't last long, right?
It didn't last long, but I sure went crazy for a minute.
Had fun with it, at least.
Yeah, absolutely.
Let's get to a few questions on here or a few comments from some people that are watching.
Okay.
Adam Krabby, he is the drummer from a band called Forever May Fall. Saliva was a massive influence on my playing, and he said, thank you. We got Bob Bones throwing the horns up there. Alina says, hello from Norway.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Hello, Norway.
I'm not going to hear the term saliva in relation to the band in the same now. Thanks.
I'm sorry.
Kristen says, my hype song will ever be Mosh Pit with 3-6 Mafia, Josey Scott, and Lil Wayne. Lil White.
Yeah.
Lil White,
yeah.
There's so many littles. It's hard to keep up with them. Somebody grow up. Remember all the biggies in the world. Never mind.
I remember the first time I heard Click Click Boom, and that was the first song I ever had heard from you. And I was at a party, and the DJ there turned you on, and just like Sid, like that was my reaction, was, who is this dude? And like everybody in the room was just like instantly into it. And that's what I like about that song and a lot of other songs that you have done, because they just get to you real fast and you never forget them. There's something that you carry. I mean, I've carried that song for years, and it's just like, yeah, it's really cool. Yeah, I like you.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Luna. That's so sweet. Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Rex has a question for you.
Okay.
Question for Josey. What was one of your favorite songs to perform live?
I really like, they're all my babies, just first and foremost. All of them are like my children. I love performing every one of them. And that's the God's honest truth. I really do love playing every song live. But my favorite one would probably be Always, because I wrote it from the woman's point of view, not from the man's point of view. And not a lot of people, some people get that, but not everybody gets that. And at the end of the song, that's why I say, does it make you feel more like a man to hit me and to do these things? Because at the time I was dating this girl, and I had a crush on her little sister.
Uh-oh.
And her little sister's boyfriend was pounding on her and like beating her and stuff. And I don't, like I said, I'm a big puppy dog until it comes to my friends or my family. And then I'm really super protective, and I'm kind of grizzly bearish. And I called this guy and I said, look, I said, if, you know, Christy is my friend, and if you put your hands on her again, I'm going to cut your fucking hands off. So don't ever put your hands on her again. And he was like, okay, I'm sorry. So I kind of went off, and I was so inspired by that moment because I used to, you know, watch my parents fight when I was a kid, and it really scared me to death. And to see that fear in a woman that I really cared about's eyes, it really triggered me and bothered me in a big way. And I was like, I have to write about this. I've always written about whatever was going on around me, you know, been really honest. My lyrics just pour out of whatever's going on around me. I can't fake it. You know what I mean? I have to write it about something real that's happening to me. So I wrote it from her perspective and from what I thought she was feeling, from what she had told me she was feeling. And then I've had women come up to me. This lady came up to me. This young girl came up to me at a meet and greet one time, and she said, I just want you to know that the song always kept the shotgun out of my mouth.
Wow.
I was like, ain't that like, I was stunned when she said that. Like, that changed me forever.
Worth it, didn't it? Moments like that make everything you go through just worth it at the end, right?
Yeah, it makes it to me, it makes life worth living and makes music worth doing.
When you're making that, when your songs are making that much of an impact on the people out right. there listening and following you, that there's no, I don't think there's no bigger honor to really, to be fair to an artist themselves, when you actually find a song that connects so deeply with a listener that they carry those songs, like Luna carries it around, to carry that song around forever, just like that young lady, just like I did myself. Bloodstained Love Story, Starting Over, was the song that stuck with me. I'm kind of the oddball. I pick the songs that don't get released on radio to be my favorites. But right. yeah, Starting Over was, for me, was monumental. It helped me get through a divorce, helped me get sober. That song was on repeat for 3 months, to be fair. That whole album was, yeah. But that song in particular, 3 months of me trying to get sober. That song was playing in my head, Starting Over. This is your chance. This is your opportunity. And it motivated me. For me, it did. It motivated me.
Yeah. You're so right, Sid. There is no bigger honor. Like, I would rather somebody come up to me and say what you've said, or what Luna said, or what that girl said about keeping the shotgun out of her mouth. Those are worth a lot more to me than Grammys or, you know, Moon Men will ever be.
Because the Moon Men are not the one listening, right? The Grammy, he's just standing there, right?
Right.
With his fucking hands by his waist, not doing jack shit. And I always wonder, why has he always got his hands in his pants?
I think you might be talking about an Oscar.
Oh, maybe I am.
The Grammy's the one with the little megaphone. It looks like a little horn. They just collect dust. It doesn't mean anything, and it means more to me to certainly have fans of the music come up and say how the it's like, I don't know of one person that's not said, I love your music, and the next thing they always say is, it helped me through a hard time in my life, or it helped me through, you know, A, B, and C in my life. And I'm just so grateful and thankful to have been a part of helping somebody like that, because, you know, you don't know what kind of mental health struggles people are going through. And if I can be of any help or assistance, then my job is done.
I'm going to be mushy for just a second. Sid hates it when I'm mushy.
Be mushy, Luna. I love it.
I'll just tell you. Well, I think that if it wasn't for you being such an impact on Sid's life, Sid wouldn't be such a positive impact on my life. So thank you.
Oh, that's so awesome.
And I guess
you so much for that, Luna.
that's true now that you brought that up. And now I'm thinking about that. You just said that's true. Because if it wasn't for his music how it was helping me get through what I was going through, I wouldn't be here where I am right here today. I'd be dead. You know, three times overdosed, one time dead. I shouldn't be here. But here I am. And certain moments in life and certain music, for me, is like the most powerful healing thing you can do is to sit back with a pair of headphones in your head and just start healing. To start find songs that you can that hits your soul when you start healing. And that their music really helped. Especially there was a song off of Survival of the Sickest, Open My Eyes, was another song that helped me get through some stuff as well. But that's here and there. We're not talking about me. We're talking about Joe.
We are talking about you.
No, we're not.
That's awesome.
I'd like to hear from Ina.
Yeah.
What? What do you want to hear from me?
What's today, Ina?
What's on your mind, Ina?
What's on my mind? Actually, I have a question, but we are not there yet. We are talking about other things, and I didn't want to spoil it. But I really, really want to ask you this question.
Okay.
I need you to tell me a bit about Dylan.
Dylan, he is my son, and he's my stepson, actually. I met him when I married my wife back in 2004. We got married May 29th, 2004 at Elvis's house. We got married at Graceland, and it was so cool. And such a great love story. I met her, and then I got to meet Dylan. I think he was 3.5 years old, and didn't get to be as much a part of his life when he was really little, except for when I was off tour. I would come to his little soccer games if I could, and his birthday parties and stuff like that. Later on, I've really gotten to spend some time with him over the past 10 years, you know, obviously being away from the band and not being on tour. And I heard in like 2007 or 8 that he was playing rock. I can't remember what it's called. The game with where they play the guitar or whatever with the music.
Oh, Rock Hero.
Yeah.
Guitar Hero.
And I found out that he was playing that, and I was like, oh yeah, he's gonna be a musician. He'll be in the band. He'll be in my band. He'll be in my band before you know it. And after he played the game for a while, he got a bass. And he started playing bass, and I was like, "Oh, every bass player is a frustrated guitar player, so he'll be playing guitar before you know it." And boom, then he picked up guitar, and for the past year, we've been started sort of jamming together when I had the house before this one, and then we moved into a different house that has like a studio above the garage. So now we actually have a place to go with all the music stuff. So we sort of set up in that band room, we call it, or the studio, and we've been jamming in there ever since and just writing new material together and getting the wheels turning. And I was like, well, you know, you should come out and do the solo project with me, because I, instead of him, you know, being in a band here at home and, you know, having to take, I just didn't want him to have to take the hard road that I had to take, you know? And I said, well, why don't you just come play guitar for me? And he was like, okay. So we've been together ever since. And we have an amazing female drummer named Tasha Jones, and she lives out in Los Angeles, and she's like I said, she's coming in. We've been sort of rehearsing online, and then she's going to come out here a couple of days before the first show, and we're going to jam out together. And the new bass player's name's Mark Dalbeth. He's going to be coming out pretty soon and jamming with us. And
where is he at? Is he in Australia? Where is he at?
He's from Australia, but he lives in.
I thought I seen where it says he's from Australia.
Yeah, he lives in Los Angeles now, and actually, I'm about to do my fourth record deal with this Australian label called Golden Robot, and I'm really excited about that. I haven't told anybody about that, so that's exclusively y'all's.
Just between us.
Yeah, I'm signing my fourth record deal with this guy from Australia called Golden Robot Records, and he's amazing. He's just really fights for the rights of musicians and really has a good plan for my socials and just has a really good game plan for me.
Jace right here says, definitely one of the breakthrough artists that shook the scene in the 2000s and paved the way. What you've achieved is gleaming. He's one of our DJs from our radio station here. I couldn't agree more. Definitely paved the way for a whole new genre of music for sure. But you guys,
oh, wow.
your stretch with Saliva was pretty fast, right? I mean, with every 6 seconds, you had Back in Your System, not too far after that, Survival of the Sickest, Bloodstained Love Story, Cinco Diablo. I mean, them were all albums that came out in a fairly short time span, really, to be fair.
Yeah. Yeah. It seems like it was longer than it was, but I don't guess it was, you know. It's time just flew by. And by 2010, when I left the band, I was ready to step down. You know, I needed to go home. I just had two little girls, and
I ask you, you know, what was did it become too taxing for you at the time with all this that was going on, the constant making of the albums, constant going out and touring for the albums? Was you just, because I know there was a point in time that you was having throat issues, vocal issues, or was that just down the rumor mill?
Well, I was having some medical issues. I had gotten an ulcer in my stomach and almost bled to death, and then I had a regular heartbeat for a minute, and they fixed that, and I just had all kinds of problems going on. I was causing a lot of those problems though, with, you know, out there trying to stay on the rock and roll horse, man. Just, you know, it's a nonstop 24-hour a day party out there, and it's hard to hang with that sort of thing.
Yeah, because I caught you right at the tail. I caught you guys playing live right at the tail end of your stay with Saliva. I caught one of the probably one of the last few. It was in Knoxville, Tennessee. It was at the Valerium. It was the radio station gave away. We won. I actually won tickets for a meet and greet, and it was supposed to be an acoustic session as well, but you was having some throat issues and you wanted to save your voice for the show. So you gave everybody that showed up free tickets to go see the show. So to me, it was a win-win because I got to hang out backstage, or not backstage, but as you guys was set up sound checks and all this other stuff, I was like, this is a win for me.
Yeah.
Sorry you feel bad, but it was a win for me.
Yeah, absolutely.
But it was a good show, but you can tell, but I think the reason why I say that is because I think when I watched the show, you can almost tell that you was getting burnt out and you was ready for that break.
I was going to this witch doctor who had me on a lot of different antidepressants, and it turns out after I studied the medications the guy had me on, I was on like stuff for people that were schizophrenic, like just Lamictal and Triazodone and just different medications that I had no business being on. But you know, I got off all that crap and got healthy and got better, thank God.
That must have been an interesting journey, right? I mean, you go from this rock and roll lifestyle to have, you know, the fame, the fortune, so to speak, and then you all of a sudden, it's gone.
Right. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
It must have been an interesting journey because you had to kind of, in a sense, had to rediscover yourself again.
Absolutely. But at the same time, I just wanted to go home and be a dad and be a husband. You know, I think once you get a big old mess of that fame and fortune, like you said, you find out that happiness ain't there either. You know, I thought, well, if I can just sell 1 million records, I'll be happy. Or if I can just be nominated for a Grammy, I'll be happy. Or if I can just win this award, I'll be happy. And if I can just buy this car or this house, I'll be happy. And I had all those things, and I continued to be unhappy. And then I started turning to chemicals to, you know, to make me, to keep me happy. And that's, you already know, that's a short-term liability right there. Absolutely. And I just couldn't find happiness. And once I got home and got cleaned up, and I just wanted to be normal, you know, after being so not normal, you know, for so many years. I just wanted to come home and drive my kids to school and, you know, go to birthday parties and take them out for pizza and stuff like that, and not have a personal trainer so I can have pizza and
all that. Double pepperoni, please.
Yes.
But it did you good. You had time to reflect and get down with the most important thing, what truly matters in life, and that's family.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. I got to, you know, fall back in love with my wife and fall back in love with my kids in a way that was so much deeper. And, you know, like I said, just getting to be a normal guy. You don't miss the water until the well runs dry, and my well had run dry, and I had to come home and find out what was truly important. You're exactly right. I had to come home and find out what was truly important to me, and family to me is everything, man.
How old are your kids now?
My kids are my son Dylan is 23, his sister Brittany is 25, and my three little ones, well, not little anymore, but my son Justice is 16, and his sister is 11, Jordan, and then the baby is Jolie, and she is 7.
Aww.
And she is a mess. She's 7 years old going on 35. We call her Little Logic because she's so smart about everything. Time we have a problem, she's like, well, Dad, why don't you just do this? And me and my wife will look at each other and be like, she's exactly right. We should.
That's how I am with mine. I'm 48, and I got a 5 and a 6-year-old. And my little one today, I went to go pick up from school, and I'm standing by the door waiting for him to come out. And the poor little guy, he just comes out the door and he sees me. And then they start taking his hands and putting them over his face, and he starts crying. And I'm like, oh, what's wrong, buddy? So he comes up to me and goes, I've had a bad day, Daddy. I had a bad day. I said, well, what happened? He goes, I don't want to talk about it, Dad. I just want a hug. And so I cut down and gave him a big old hug. And then next thing you know, tears dried up. He's like, let's party, bro. Let's do it. Let's go get some Wendy's. That'll put a smile on your face.
That's the moments that mean so much to me, is when you can get down on their level and hug them and hold them and tell them that it's going to be all right.
And I'm going to miss that too.
Yeah.
I'm going to miss it. Cause I wouldn't have been a good father in my younger days, but I'm glad that I had kids now that I'm older, cause I'm more settled down. I'm not near as wild, and I'm not in and out of jail as much.
Right.
But yeah, kids are everything. Family's everything, and I'm glad that you got away from it. and you took that break and you rediscovered what you're doing in life, what direction you want to do in life. I'm absolutely 100% ecstatic that you're back in the scene again.
Thank you, brother.
When I caught wind of it on Facebook and I seen an ad or something like that, I can't remember how I found it. I was like, he's coming back? Josie's coming back. I was like, you know what? I'm so happy because, you know, I missed you. I missed the music. I missed watching you guys play live. I missed listening to the music. Most importantly, it's your guys' vibe, you know? You guys, you're a legend, man. To be fair,
you guys paved the way.
I mean, you guys paved the way for a whole new genre. You guys, your era actually, for me, saved rock music.
Oh, thank you so much. That's so sweet. Your words are so kind. I really appreciate you guys so much. Thank all three of you for having me.
Thanks for hanging out.
No, actually, thank you because you gave me a chance to tell my brother to suck it because he asked me, what are you doing today? And I said, we're interviewing Josey Scott. He said, Josey Scott? You mean the dude from Hero? And I said, yeah. And he was like, I'm over it. Anyway, I have something to rub to his face, so I'm good.
I think we all do
so that. Thank you for that. Yeah.
Oh, man. Thank you guys for having me. You guys are so much fun.
Well, it could be a lot more fun, but I've toned it down.
Yeah.
Oh, I hear you. I appreciate that.
No, we toned it down. I've had people come on here actually take their balls out and weigh them on a scale.
Oh, my God.
It's true, though.
I've had them come here and try to break eggs over their crotch.
Nice.
I've had them make out with teddy bears.
Wow.
So, yeah, you got the calm. You got the PG version of the show.
PG-13 version.
Found yourself right, lucky. Well,
thank you guys so much for having me, man. I'm going to run and go get with my family and get them out of here.
On the show. Once again, everybody, you can find Josey right here on Facebook, Josey Scott. Go find and go to his website, joseyscott.com. You can catch up on all his tour dates. He just released some, I think, today. Where some upcoming shows he's going to be at. Be sure to go follow his page, Josey Scott, right here on Facebook. Thank you once again, Josey. Enjoy your family time. Thanks for hanging out with us, brother. It is good to see you back. Honestly, it is.
Thank you, guys. I'll see you next time, hopefully. All right.
You guys have a good night. Well, we're going to end tonight with one of Josey's songs. This is, I found one. This is If You Want to Get to Heaven. You guys have a great night. We'll catch you guys on the flip side.
Bye.